Second last to Bleach chapter review on this channel ever, or is it? We'll talk about that later on down the road, but let me just say, you guys saw the live reaction. If you didn't, go check it out. It was a very emotional chapter for me. It really hit me in so many different ways imaginable, and it really hit me when I saw that Sokyoku heal. Now, seriously, like, I know Uwatch had destroyed it. Obviously, just what Uwatch did throughout that war when he came into the Soul Society was literally reconstruct everything in a very destructive way. And just to see the old Soul Society get taken down and then built anew kind of put me in a state of, wow, this is going to be a new era. This is not the same Soul Society I walked into. Instead, it looks better, it looks cleaner, it looks, I don't know, it's just like we got new captains, we got new faces, the old laws just seem to be abolished, you know, because Genryu Sai is not going to be there anymore, and this is a nicer place, I guess. And this has all been caused because of one guy, that being Ichigo, and I really can't wait to just see next chapter, because it's going to be fantastic. It's gonna raise so many eyebrows, it's gonna answer so many questions, and I love that even that this is the second to last chapter, Kubo still throws in the curveball of, hey, what's gonna happen next chapter? And I love that, because he knows that his series is ending in one chapter, but he doesn't give a fuck. He's like, I'm still gonna progress the story somehow. And it's kind of like, why? Just what have you got planned? With that being said, like, seeing the certain stuff that's happened within the chapter, I will address what I think the special announcement is, but you'll have to wait for the end. So you have to watch the video to the end, or you could just skip, but watch the video till the end, because it, you know, it's just nice. It's a nice thing to do. No, but in all seriousness, I did find that there was a lot of subliminal messages within this chapter. I think many people clocked onto the subliminal messages. And even though, like, again, with all the stuff that's happened within the Soul Society, many people were upset by this chapter in a very angry way and a very emotional way. I was more than the emotional way, more than angry. There is a lot of stuff that's wrong with this arc in general. There's a lot of questions that need answers, and this chapter didn't really help those. Instead, sometimes it mocked those questions we had. But that's what I love about the chapter, is that it was very self-aware, and Kubo understood us, and whether he was taking the piss, or he was trying to laugh at his own jokes, I guess to say. I don't know. But we see stuff like this with Shunsui, for example, when Nanao is trying to call him over for the celebration that's going to be happening for the announcement of the new 13 Court Guard Squad, Rukia Kuchiki, which I'll talk about her in a minute. But as he's like having this monumental moment with Ukitake that's dead, and even though people say, you know, oh, what did Ukitake do in this war, he's done a lot to the story, believe it or not. Like, he has been a character which, as much as we would love to get more of this character, he did so much stuff in the background, and that's why we love him, and that's why we're angry that we didn't get to see more of him. But we can still sympathize on that level with Kyoraku when he's there drinking a sake cup next to his grave, because we know we already have a connection towards Ukitake, whether we like it or not, whether he did anything or not, it doesn't matter, because we still bonded with Ukitake. We still liked him as a character. He was a great character, and we know why he did the stuff that he needed to do. But going back to the subliminal messages, Kyoraku was telling Nanao that, you know, some people just can't appreciate his pace, and that they could learn a lot from an old mountain man. Obviously, Kubo's getting old now, and his pacing has been rushed exponentially. Maybe that's subliminal message number one. And just rereading that segment as a whole, it feels like we were the Ukitake and Kubo was the Kyoraku, and he's talking to us saying, you know, he'll be back to talk to us some more. And yeah, that's another thing why it struck to me that did. And then let's talk about the play on words with the perfect end title card, because we all know this wasn't the perfect end, and maybe Kubo was just taking the piss out of the fact. But to add a bit of black Reishi coming from the floorboards has just left everyone in, who could this be? What is this? Is Uwar back? Is this Aizen? Is this Ichigo? I know, just so many questions. So, do you know what? Let's fucking talk about that. Let's talk about that. When Uobok died, the whole world was supposed to collapse. Soul Society, World of the Living, Heiko Mundo, maybe not Hell, but the Soul Palace as well. These were supposed to break down, because without someone in charge of the balance, there is no balance and everything is destroyed. So technically, there has to be a replacement. Somebody right now within this chapter is Soul King. Well, not in this chapter, but while the 10 years is going on, someone has been Soul King for 10 years. Now, what we could do, we could go back to the World of the Living, or we could go to Heiko Mundo, or we could go back to the Soul Palace to see who the new Spirit King is, and who is the new Spirit King, we have three candidates. Aizen either came back and he took his place as Spirit King, or it could be the man himself, Urahara Kisuke. Sure, he could stay in the world of the living. I think he quite enjoys it. I think he's very peaceful there. I think he would like to go back to the Soul Society because he has attempted a few times in trying to get through that gateway again. I feel like he has, you know, that nostalgia to wanting to go back. Or he could be the Soul King, of course. You know, it's always a possibility. I think I would actually prefer him to be Soul King. I think he knows a lot and he understands a lot of the history behind it. Whereas Aizen, he's a fishy guy. You need someone powerful to defeat him. So they were saying that's one from Squad Zero, Ichibei, maybe. He was a war potential, so maybe he's the new Soul King. Who knows? That's a big possibility. And maybe someone, maybe Kisuke Urahara is in fact Squad Zero material. Maybe he's a captain, he's a Squad Zero captain. Who knows? This is really out of the park and I really can't wait to see the next chapter, but I don't think we're gonna get a coverage of what's gonna happen or everything that we want to know. I don't think we're gonna get what happened to Haribel, what happened to Grimmjow, what happened to the Fallbringers. We're not going to get everything. And please don't get angry by that fact. Kubo has done so fantastically well with everything he's trying to wrap up, and I think he's doing a fantastic job to make a chapter like this to show us each individual captain of how they're like acting personality wise, just the peace that they've had. It's just, I would say, it's a beautiful thing. He wrapped that up very nicely. He's brought balance back into the Soul Society, especially with the captains, the order, and just everything around it. We do need to know who's the new Spirit King, and that's without a doubt, and I do think it's Kisuke Urahara. Maybe Itachi by his side, who knows? I mean, she was a royal family member, so who knows? With Kukaku Shiba, maybe? Hey, it's possible. But then again, Kyoraku did say that Ichigo may not be able to return to the world of the living, so whether Ichigo took on that role, it's possible. But I feel like Kyoraku or Aizen or Kisuke would oblige to that and say, hell no. Because Ichigo's got so much of a life ahead of him, and I think the captains really appreciate all that they've done, and they want him to have freedom. They want him to have a happy life at this point. So I don't think, unless Ichigo really wanted this, that he is going to be Soul King, because I think that would be very generic. I wouldn't disagree with it, but I think it is generic. But back to talking about self-awareness, let's talk about Shuhei, because Shuhei, it was just funny. They were talking about his Bankai. Kubo didn't forget it at all. He said he didn't have a chance in the war to actually use it, which I say, bollocks, mate. You had every fucking opportunity to use it. You just didn't. But that could also mean, hey, like, I was rushed to shit, so I couldn't have time to fit him in the fight that I wanted him to have. Maybe he was going to have a fight with the Miracle. Maybe he was going to have the perfect counter to the Miracle. Who knows? Another interesting question while saying that also, is actually Kisuke dead from, you know, that whole explosion with Asken? That'd be insane. But Kubo right in the fields again with Nemuri. Nanago. Sorry, it's Hachigo. Because she is in fact the new Nemu. I don't know if it's the same brain that's in this body that has all this history planted onto her. We don't know. The Nemus are very difficult because we know he improves with each Nemu that he creates. So hopefully, like, later on down the road, if there is a sequel or something, we do get to see more of that relationship. But the character development in and of itself with Mayuri Kuritsuchi, just being nice and not treating his daughter like shit. He has grown so much. Like, this Mayuri, he's been really tsundere about it. Like, hey, there's no need to shout. Like, he's giving the old daddy, you know, obedience, but, like, he's not being the piece of shit that he was back in the Soul Society where we first met him. And I think that was absolutely beautiful because I just saw Nemu's face and just how happy she looks, and I was just like, that's adorable. That is absolutely fantastic. Little things as well, such as Ikkaku being the now lieutenant and Yimichika being the third seat, because obviously he likes that number, because obviously he went to fifth seat because he didn't like the sound of fourth seat. It wasn't a beautiful number. Still got that trait on, but he's third seat, so that's awesome. I'm glad that they're really still close. Shinji, on the other hand, has grew his hair a little bit. Like, it used to be like up to his ear long or up to his jaw long, and now it's a little bit more further down towards his neck now. So his hair, he is grown it back out by the looks of it from the Turn Back the Pendulum days. But can I just say, Momo, like, she's just been getting more adorable. Each arc that I see her in, she just gets more and more cuter. Like, I'm really digging Momo. Like, right now, she got rid of the fucking bun, and she looks adorable. I'll say it here first. I love Momo's new design. She looks cute as fuck. But my one complaint in this chapter is Tetsuzaimon. Now, we could be jumping the gun, because we never got to see what Tetsu Zaimon could do, or Iba, as many of you guys would know him, because obviously we saw his released sword. We don't know its name. We don't know anything Tetsu Zaimon can do as a lieutenant. He was the most closed off lieutenant that nobody actually knew. And the sad thing is, he could be extremely powerful and he could be worth his captain's seat, or he could not, because he didn't do anything in said war. I understand he was very loyal to his captain and he was looking after, you know, Komamura, which is probably a pet dog at this point, or is in fact dead. We don't know. But I'm not feeling Tetsu Zaimon as captain, because he hasn't demonstrated to me anyway that he is captain material. Sure, that means he now has a Bankai if he's captain. Cool, he has a Bankai. We didn't know what his fucking Shikai did, so it's really pointless in us knowing that. That's the only issue I just had. Tetsu Zaimon, I love your character design, and I love your attitude when you talk with Ikkaku. You just deserved more screen time. If you had a little bit of that, if we knew a little bit more about you, then yes, maybe I could debate whether you are captain material. But at this point, because we know literally nothing about you, I'm sorry, dude, you are not worth captain level material. So, and you know, I find something very funny with the whole time skip that we've had. We've had 10 years, and the way Shuhei and Tetsu Zaimon and Rikyu even are now somewhat of higher power, because you know, you are going to get stronger within 10 years, and it's 10 years specifically. I mean, this isn't such a random number. Toshiro did say, you know, as Shuhei was talking about his Bankai, that it's a great thing that he hasn't been able to use his Bankai, because that means 10 years of peace. Now, don't you guys want to question why it's 10 years specifically? I'm gonna throw it in the dark and say, how long does it take a captain or someone of captain level to learn or perfect or train their Bankai? Byakuya said it was 10 years, and it's 10 years later, and Rukia is now a captain. Her Bankai was strong as fuck, but was absolutely ineffective to use in battle because of the restraints it just had on her body, the absolute damage it would have self-conflicted on her. So the fact that it's taken 10 years for her to become a captain means that she's fully able to control it, which is a big fucking deal. Now, whether it's the same with Ikkaku or whether it's the same with Shuhei, we'll never know. But still, the fact that we're seeing proof of a lieutenant such as, again, Tetsu Zaimon, don't really want to throw your name out there, but Rukia, the fact that she's become a captain 10 years later, knowing her Bankai and knowing the vast improvements that she would need to go through, just proves that Byakuya was right. You need 10 years to complete and train and build up your Bankai to its fullest potential, and I think that's what Rukia has done. So we can assume at this point that Rukia's Bankai is stronger than Absolute Zero than we already know right now. So that's, in and of itself, a reason for why Kubo chose 10 years as a time skip. I would like to give some praise to Isane. I mean, Kyona being her lieutenant, adorable. But Isane, captain, the thing is, my issues with a captain is, if you're gonna give you a lieutenant, you know, that captain position, someone like Isane, yes, she's strong, she can heal, she's very good, you know, she's been around Unohana for a very long time, and this confirms that obviously Unohana died. But the one thing about Unohana is that, yeah, she was a carefree, loving woman, but you fucked her off and she gave you that death stare. You knew you were fucked up if you messed with Unohana. And that's what I love about Unohana as the 4th Division captain, because if you're in the 4th Division, you know, you were very much ridiculed for just being the healer class, you know, you weren't a proper squad in the eyes of everyone else. Again, this is a new Soul Society, so it might be a little bit different, especially in Squad 11's eyes, but like in this position like that Isane is in, she needs to have a backbone. This is a squad that is a healing squad, but can be outclassed or outmatched by a lot of the other squads within the Soul Society. So I feel like she needs that Unohana, like, kind of tough skin to her to kind of, you know, be that iron hand. Maybe she'll learn it over time, but Unohana put that shit down. She knew, people knew not to fuck with her when she was in her presence. And maybe Isane, like, she's captain, but will people really take her seriously? Regardless of what, I loved it. She deserved to be captain level. Now, Lieutenant Hinataro, then again, I don't think Hinataro has really got the balls either to be lieutenant status. So scenes as Kyone has been a bit of a higher seat, sharing that third seat when she was with Ukitake. It kind of makes a little bit more sense. She kind of knows how to work things a little bit better, and she has a bit more of a reputation. I do hope that Hanataro has gone up in the ranks, that, you know, above from 7th seat, maybe to 4th or 3rd seat. That would have been nice to see. But just getting confirmations on Rose still being alive and Kensei, again, iffy and specky, you know, I still would like more clarification on that. I would have liked to anyway, but I'm not going to go into a rant about it because it's not rant worthy. But Lisa being there as obviously the 8th division as well, she's obviously cut off a bit of her captain's clothes. She's got her own design going for her. Love it. Still got the skirt game on point. So, Lisa, you're good. I think she deserves it. She's strong. She's proved that she's mercifulness, that, you know, she can fight in a battle. And it's just great as an overall aspect to see that the Soul Society are accepting captain level people with holo masks. You know, since that incident of, you know, holo NX Shinigami, you know, it was outruled law that couldn't happen. It was a disgrace. It was just an unethical thing to hear of in the Soul Society. Just to see that a few of them are in fact captains now just shows that there has been a big diversity change, especially there's a lot of female captains compared to before. There's kind of a lot of, you know, holo and Shinigami captains in there, and just Shinigami captain. I love the diversity that we've got. Everyone's unique in their own right. And just seeing Rukia blush was absolutely adorable. And do you know what I loved about this? It wasn't the fact that she was a captain. It wasn't the fact that she was blushing. It was the fact that her hair had grown really, like, not really long, but long enough to almost resemble Hisana. And for some reason, I feel like, you know, Byaki is there looking at the floor because he's like, shit, I've got like the biggest boner right now. I need to control this. Because she's almost looked like her older sister. And that just gave me the goosebumps when I saw that. Like, I had this rush of energy just go through me going, wow, that looks like Hisana. Like, that's crazy. So she's still keeping the Rukia look, but she has a little bit of Hisana in her. And I'm just like, that's adorable. And that's like a great, I think that was definitely intentional from Kubo to give us that kind of flash vision of that, because it just pays moral respect. And Byaki is probably there like, fuck. And then you got Renji over here going, yeah boy. So I just feel Byakuya's salty levels are just fucking skyrocketing right now. But regardless of what, at the end of the chapter we get a big flash forward of there's going to be Reishi that resembles Yuar Bark. Now this could resemble the Spirit King, this could resemble Quincy, this could resemble Aizen, Ichigo, or Yuwatch. Is it Yuwatch? Is it Aizen? Is it Ichigo? Don't know. I think they'd know if it was Ichigo. So is it Aizen's or Yuwatch's? That's the only two candidates which are going to be similar, because obviously Aizen was absorbed by Yuwatch. Now, there is a big, massive theory going on right now about Yuwatch and about the 10 years. Is that when Yuwatch said towards the end that he would kill everyone, in a sense, I'm just giving you the rundown, that he would kill everyone at a time where it's most peaceful to them. As, you know, Toshiro said, is that it is at its most peaceful right now. They've had 10 years, everything's getting rebuilt, they are back on their feet. So there is a humongous chance that Yuwatch could come back. How do I feel about it? I don't know. We've got one chapter. I'm gonna just have to see where this goes, because whatever this announcement is gonna be humongous. But without going any more into it, I'm gonna catch them up, because like, you guys of course have this fine day been Hanson. Let's enjoy the last Bleach chapter together, people. So again, same thing, live stream next week, be there or be a square loser. I don't know where that was gonna go, but peace out, guys.